We want Mungia, baby.
They demanded it. They got it. Who will regret it? Mungia versus Rosado. Saturday, November 13th. Download the app.
Hey, Fight fans, welcome to The Breakdown presented by Casa Mexico Tequila. I'm Beto Duran, excited to be joined by the golden boy himself, Hall of Famer, Oscar De La Hoya. Now, November 13th, Honda Center in Orange County, Mungia, Rosado. Why are you so excited about this fight?
Styles make fights. And Mungia has been coming off some great wins back-to-back. But you take a look at Rosado, what he did to Beck in his last fight was, I mean, obviously knockout of the year. And the fact that he's confident, the fact that he's coming into this fight trained by Freddie Roach, training at Wild Card, with the confidence, coming in with the experience that he possesses. He's been in there with Triple G. He's been in there with some really, really good fighters, great fighters. So it's about styles. It's about confidence. It's about experience. So this fight probably calls for fight of the year.
But Oscar, sometimes when a promoter has one of their hot prospects get knocked out or they lose, they don't bring in the guy who beat him to fight another one of their top guys. Why are you messing with Gabe Rosado?
Well, look, I mean, we're all about making great fights at Golden Boy. But when you have two fighters who believe in themselves, who want to fight each other, who want to create exciting fights for the fans, it's a win-win for everybody. And so this fight, Gabriel wanted it. Mungia wanted this fight. We obviously wanted this fight as Golden Boy. And it's the right fight to make at the perfect time. And we just feel that the fans are in for a special treat.
Without a doubt, they're going to be in for a special treat. This November 13th, Gabe Rosado, originally from Philadelphia, now training here in Southern California. King Gabe Rosado. You see the KGR logo. You even had that tattoo. Gabe, how are you feeling, man? How's training going?
I feel great. You know, training camp is going great with Freddie Roach. You know, we got a good momentum going on, you know, going back-to-back fights, you know, feeling like I had a great performance against Daniel Jacobs and then, you know, knocking out Beck. Now going into this fight, you know, I just feel like timing is everything, you know, and being in a rhythm and staying active, you know, definitely helps a lot, you know. So I'm definitely enjoying training camp and having a good, healthy training camp.
Now, why do you want the Mungia fight?
Man, you know, to me, this is a legacy fight. You know, it's historical. You know, you got a young, hungry lion. You know, I'm a veteran, you know, and I feel like I'm just getting better with Freddie. You know, this is our fourth fight together. And each fight, we just get better and better. You know, and I think it just comes down to, like, the professionalism that Freddie brings to a training camp. You know, it's just all business. It's all work. You know, so I'm excited, man. I think the fans are going to definitely see fight of the year.
Gabriel, so when I was watching the Beck fight, right, live there with Bernard Hopkins, another legendary fighter from Philly, from the East Coast, who has that mentality, right, who has the experience. When you went down on one knee, right, and when Beck hit you, you know, Hopkins told me, watch, he's not hurt. He's actually giving confidence to Beck so he can continue coming forward. So I thought to myself, wow, this is a fighter who is, you know, you call these fighters throwback fighters, fighters who have experience, fighters who know how to lure in these young, inexperienced fighters to a real dogfight. So were you hurt? Were you thinking about, okay, let me lure him in? I mean, what was going through your mind at that moment?
Well, you know, I've had 13 training camps with Bernard Hopkins, so I learned a lot from Bernard. You know, and a lot of things that I've learned from Bernard are things that have kicked in for me now at this point in my career, right? So, you know, Beck, he landed a good shot. I wasn't hurt, but he got on an attack where he kept throwing big shots after big shots. So, you know, in the midst of it, it's the first round. And I'm thinking to myself, this is a long fight. This is a 12-round fight. I don't have to get into this, like, firefight with him right away in this first round. Let me warm up into this. And so me taking the knee was for me to regroup and come stronger in the next round. So I took the knee. He got overconfident. And then I began to counter him. And that's how I began to set him up, because he got extremely confident, where he was just kind of throwing bombs, and I was just keeping my defense tight, and I was looking at holes in between to be able to counter him and make his aggression work against him.
Yeah, that's why I love listening to two fighters talk about an actual fight. That insight that you saw sure. It there. Gabe told us that was part of the game plan. Now let's look back at that fight. Time to go for a breakdown of Gabe Rosado's last fight against Bekdemir Melikuziev. So you look good right there, Referee talking to you. What'd you see right there when you saw him across the ring for the first time?
You know, I just knew that this kid was a young, hungry, strong fighter. But I just knew that he wasn't going to bring anything to the table that I haven't seen. I knew he packed I knew his dangerous shot was the left hook to the body. So I mentally prepared myself for that punch. So right here, I was just kind of filling him out, seeing where the punches are coming from. Cause he throws from, awkward angles. You know, he's not like a traditional puncher. He's punching really wide. And they're just kind of just filling him out in the first round.
See, one thing about young fighters who have power, who think they hit hard. I mean, they do hit hard. If you can withstand that barrage of punches and take their power, then you can figure them out. You can figure them out eventually. And once you see that opening, once you see that the fighter is confident, you can take advantage of it.
That was it right there, right, Gabe? That was
strategic. Right there, he opened up. I wasn't hurt. But the thing is that being it is the first round and, he just kind of went into his attack mode, I figured, before he lands another heavy body shot, let me just regroup. And then as you can see here, I'm pressing him. So I got my guard up, right? So as you can see, I'm pressing. So I come in, I'm purposely making him punch because I'm just looking for holes. Sure. So see, my guard is up. And then, I just want him to throw because I want to counter right in between. So as you can see,
I was actually talking to Bernard here, and not that we were surprised that you were staying right in front of him, but Bernard was saying, look, you watch him. He's luring him in. He's tricking him into throwing punches, more punches than what he's used to.
Yep. And so, then when I'm walking him, I'm actually throwing a hard jab. So, I'm just not walking in naked. I'm walking in with a jab. So, he'll throw right here. And I think I countered him with a hook to the body. And he's coming. So, he's pressing.
Yeah, Beck was a silver medalist, a bunch of over 300 amateur fights. He was, becoming the boogeyman, just knocking everybody out.
Yeah.
And when you watched it going into this fight, you knew what you were going to get yourself into.
Here he goes.
Yeah.
The experience is what just helped you out, right, Gabe?
Yeah. And it's the experience, but it's just not an experience. It's just the work. You have to. My sparring partner for this fight was Zuldo Ramirez, so me and Zuldo were putting a lot of rounds, and Zuldo's a big guy, big puncher. So being able to spar a guy that was that big, and it prepared me for this guy. See, as you can see right there, I countered him with a hook. He comes in, countered him with another hook. So I was already measuring him. I was catching his rhythm every time he jumped in.
What I'm noticing now is that you're throwing right hooks and hitting him and then making a miss. Yep. So now what that tells me, you're timing him now, right?
Yeah. And then right here, he's throwing, but I'm catching all of it. I see it. See right there, I counter a left hook to the body. He throws, I try to counter another left hook to the body. So he's throwing, but he's just throwing and hoping for the best. Where I'm kind of right here, I lower him in and he jumps in and I flip him. Yeah.
Beautiful right hand, right on the chin.
What does that feel like? I know it's a stupid question. I know it's a stupid question from the stupid reporter, but what does that feel like?
No, as soon as I punched him, it's like when a baseball player hits a home run and he flips his bat, like he knows it's out of the park.
I mean, you just know.
I hit him,
it's like the perfect tee shot.
Sure, it's like Tiger Woods hitting a perfect shot, and you twirl your club, and
I just knew as soon as I clipped him. The way his body dropped, I knew it was over. Yeah.
Have you ever hit anybody like that before?
That's probably the biggest knockout I've had, man. But, you know, it happens. You know, you clip guys in sparring or in a fight where you just know, you just know it. You got them.
Yeah.
It's just a perfect punch. That punch was actually a shot that Freddie wanted me to work on. We worked on it the whole camp. So, like, a lot of the times I was trying to, like, pivot an angle and throw a hook. And Freddie saw the opportunity of just letting he wanted me to squat low to take away the left hook to the body from Beck.
Yeah.
And then as Beck is coming in, just time him perfectly with the right hand. So that was actually a shot that, you know, Freddie saw in camp.
Yeah, well, you definitely threw a perfect punch, a perfect knockout. You have the perfect trainer for you. So we definitely wish you all the very best with the Munguia fight. And we know you're in great shape. We're looking forward to it. And we're looking forward to a great fight.
Thank you. And I'm excited. You know, this is a fight that I want to give the fans exactly what the hype is all about. You know, some fights get hyped up, but this is a fight where I know I have to deliver. Like, I know I have to come into this ring, to this fight, and bring my very best. Because, like I said, this fight goes down in history and is a legacy fight. So, you know, you're going to get the best of Gabriel Rosado come November 13th.
And you'll see that November 13th. Honda Center taking on Tijuana's Jaime Munguia. Gabe Rosado, appreciate you as always, man. Good luck. Now joining us live from camp in Mexico, Tijuana's very own, the undefeated Jaime Munguia. All right, Jaime, you said that you want to win 4 titles in 4 different weight classes. What would that mean to you? Jaime, dijiste que quieres ganar títulos en 4 clases como tu entrenador, Eric Morales. ¿Por qué?
Pues la verdad, pues es un sueño que tengo el ganar diferentes títulos en diferentes pesos. Obviamente, pues ya lo hice en la 154, pienso hacerlo y lo voy a hacer en la 160. Pienso que tal vez en un par de años, tal vez 3, voy a estar en 68. Y pues no dudo que en algún futuro en 75, primeramente Dios.
Yeah, it's a dream of mine. I've already won at 154. Hopefully next is 160, then after in a couple of years be 168, and then probably finish it up at 175. How's your training going for this fight? ¿Cómo va el entrenamiento para esta pelea?
Bien, fíjate que muy bien. Estamos ahorita pues en la etapa más fuerte, ya cerrando el entrenamiento. La verdad es que pues me siento bastante fuerte, me siento mejor que nunca. Creo que hasta la fecha ha sido mi mejor preparación. De peso vamos súper bien, entonces creo que va a ser una gran noche el 13 de noviembre para mí y para todo el público.
It's probably been one of my best camps. I feel like I'm in the best shape right now. I'm on point, I'm on my weight, and I think November 13th is going to give you a good fight. All right, Jaime, I can mirar tu última pelea. Let's go look at the breakdown from his last fight. ¿Qué miraste aquí? ¿Estás listo para esta pelea? What did you see here? How'd you feel?
Sí, estábamos listos. La verdad es que me sentía bastante bien. Pues estaba contento de estar regresando al ring con gente, con el público. La verdad es que me sentía bastante emocionado y muy motivado. Entonces, la verdad, estábamos contentos.
I was excited to get back. It was in El Paso, so there was fans there. So it was good to see. ¿Y qué miras en la pelea? Dime lo que miras. Tell me what you see.
Pues yo miro un Jaime Munguía, obviamente, pues concentrado, paciente, esperando el momento, trabajando con el jab, golpes a la media distancia, en veces a mi larga distancia, corto. Pues vamos, voy ahora sí que trabajando poco a poco, inteligente. Pues es lo que estábamos haciendo.
Sabíamos, Jaime, es Oscar, sabíamos que este contrincante era pues... se cambió, ¿no? El contrincante al último minuto.
Sí.
Tenías que ajustar tu plan de ataque, tu plan de pelea. ¿Cómo te sentiste cuando por primera vez estabas cerca de él tirando combinaciones? ¿Tenías que cambiar todo tu plan?
Sí, pues obviamente en el plan de trabajo, pues obviamente estábamos trabajando pues cosas que se miran ahí, pues trabajar un poco más mi defensa, mi distancia, combinaciones de golpes y obviamente pues tratamos de ajustar un poco en el gimnasio y ya en la pelea pues es donde hicimos todos esos ajustes, ya pues yo viendo cómo se comportaba el rival, ya con mi esquina cuando llegaba, pues me decían que iba bien, que lo mantuviera así con el jab, que estuviera trabajando golpes rectos al cuerpo, ganchos. Entonces la verdad creo que pues también mi esquina me ayudó bastante.
Yeah, to paraphrase, he said, you know, we had already done work in the gym. I want to make sure throw my jab and my hook and just work with the corner of what our plan was going to be. That's the paraphrasing of that one. Y pero cuando la pelea andaba, ¿cómo te sentiste? When the fight was going on, how did you feel?
¿Cómo
te sentiste en la pelea?
Bien, la verdad es que me sentí bastante fuerte. Me sentí muy rápido, continuo. La verdad es que no me cansé nada en la pelea, pude hacer bastantes combinaciones de golpes, pues ahora sí que podía hacer lo que yo quería.
Felt strong, felt fast, and I could feel like I could do whatever I want. It was probably one of my better ones.
Fíjate que esta pelea contra Rosado obviamente va a ser diferente estilo, diferente contrincante. Pero te quiero preguntar, ¿has pensado la rivalidad entre México y Puerto Rico? ¿Has tenido que hacer ajustes? Digo, por ejemplo, sabemos que hay mucha historia entre México y Puerto Rico. ¿Quieres salir agresivo? ¿Quieres salir a noquear? ¿Qué es tu plan de ataque para esta pelea contra Rosado?
Obviamente, mi plan siempre es noquear, ¿no? Siempre es ir a buscar el knockout. Obviamente, pues tengo que estar, estar bien concentrado, el estar listo para aguantar los 12 rounds. Como tú dices, la rivalidad entre México y Puerto Rico, pues se ha visto a lo largo de la historia, ¿no? Entonces tengo que tratar de controlar todas esas emociones, porque pues se puede venir un golpe como el que se le vino a Beck. Entonces tenemos, como te digo, tenemos que estar bien concentrados y bien atentos a lo que estamos haciendo y a lo que va a hacer Gabriel Rosado también.
The plan is for a knockout. I always look for a knockout, but I'm also ready to go all 12 rounds. And regarding the Mexico-Puerto Rico rivalry, you said, I know there's a lot of history behind that, but I got to go and keep my game plan together. Also, I got to make sure that I keep my guard up because I saw what he did against Beck the Bully with that knockout. Y miraste la pelea contra Beck. You saw the fight against Beck. ¿Qué pensaste de eso? What did you think of that fight?
Pues yo pienso que obviamente fue un golpe que se le acomodó, y yo pienso que Gabriel Rosado pues lo estuvo buscando, lo miró y lo estaba viendo, lo estaba esperando hasta que logró recibirlo. Creo que pues Beck era mucho más fuerte que Gabriel Rosado. Obviamente pues la inteligencia y la experiencia que tiene Gabriel Rosado fueron los que lo sacaron adelante. Porque se vio que en el primer round tocó la lona por un golpe al cuerpo. La verdad yo veía que Beck era mucho más fuerte que él, que lo estaba arrollando, pero pues supo hacer bien las cosas y de eso se trata.
Yeah, to paraphrase, he said, I saw the fight and it looked to me like Gabriel Rosado was setting him up looking for that one punch and he was able to land it. But also with, you saw it, I felt like Beck had more power in that first round, even dropping Rosado, but it was a perfect game plan for him, and I have to go and attack my own.
Pues la última pregunta, campeón. Sabemos que has estado en las montañas entrenando. Nosotros boxeadores tenemos una disciplina, no solamente con el entrenamiento, pero también la dieta. Una pregunta. ¿Cuáles tacos te vas a comer después de la pelea? ¿De qué carne?
De carne asada, así de ahí de Tijuana.
Eso, ahí de la Somadera. Puro Tijuana, vamos.
Saludos a los de la Somadera.
Gracias.
Oscar asked, like, you know, the fighters are very disciplined. You guys are in training, you're in diet, the tacos. Unos tacos de carne asada, fácil, right? Carne asada tacos, real easy.
Sí, carne asada tacos.
¿Pero cuántos? How many?
Pues unos 10.
10 carne asada tacos coming your way for Jaime Munguia. Jaime was training in Otomil, which is high in the mountains of Mexico, like about an hour away of Mexico City. We appreciate you and good luck to you November 13th. Suerte el 13 de noviembre, campeón.
Gracias, campeón.
Muchas gracias. Saludos a todos.
You know, I'm pumped after talking to both of them. How you feeling?
I'm pumped because he's going to have carne asada tacos after the fight.
I think we all should, right? So for everybody involved on the show, thank you so much for watching it. November 13th, Honda Center, Munguia, Rosado will go after it. Thanks again to Casa Mexico, the sponsor for the show. So for Oscar De La Hoya, I'm Beth Duran. Thank you. We'll see you November 13th.